Hello, everyone. Today we're going to be talking about multi-omics, machine learning, and MECFS. So these are obviously very complicated terms, but these are just some of the tools that we're utilizing to try and better understand MECFS in our research group. I'm joined here with Kathy, who's actually going to be talking a little bit about this work that she's been doing in this space. Thank you very much, Kathy, for being here. And first of all, I just wanted to ask you kind of how you got involved with MECFS and what you're thinking about why you've been around and continuing your work in MECFS after completing your PhD.
Thanks for the opportunity, Chris. So I actually started my research career in the same lab that Chris did his PhD, and I also worked on NMR metabolomics. And then I slowly started becoming interested in machine learning and data analytics, which is th then how I started my PhD project with Chris and got introduced to MECFS. And then as I was doing my project, more and more people, friends and family, started telling me that they also know someone who has ME/CFS or that they're a caregiver. And that's one of the reasons why I think our research is so important and why I'm going to continue doing our research to help all the people that we never knew that had ME/CFS.
Yeah, I think that's kind of what I was saying. It's very similar to how I got interested in MECFS. It was really working in this space, kind of get to know people who have it, but also, you get to learn like a lot of information about this problem that people have, and I guess some of the injustice that they experience as well in response within the medical community, and how little tools and things there are to help this patient population. And so I guess that kind of brings us into kind of what Kathy's really interested in. Kathy's really interested in developing tools, I guess, for this for patients. And in particular, for a PhD, the work was really looking towards diagnostics or markers with this in this illness. And she's had a couple of great papers from her PhD. That one that was published in the Nature Journal Communications Medicine more recently, and obviously we have another one as well going in. So, Kathy, I thought maybe you could just give like a little overview of kind of what you did during your PhD, in particular that research paper.
So majority of my PhD focused on analyzing data from the UK Biobank, which is a valuable resource for the ME/CFS research community because we can take this opportunity to investigate multiple conditions where in small scale studies it's not quite feasible to be able to analyze different comorbid conditions. So in the study that we did in the Nature Communications Medicine paper, we tried to de we developed a differential diagnostic model to identify ME/CFS cases from common comorbid conditions. So in the UK Biobank, we found that 83% of the ME/CFS cohort reported additional comorbid condition. And the common conditions included hypertension, depression, asthma, irritable bowel syndrome, hypothyroidism, high fever, and migraine. And these are the conditions that we chose to compare ME/CFS against. And then through machine learning training, model development, we found that 28 health factors, both objective and subjective, were able to act accurately predict ME/CFS with 83% accuracy. And some of these health factors included immature reticulocyte fraction, various ketone bodies, leucine, and lipoprotein particle concentrations.
So the important thing to highlight, I think, is that what you're looking at is a patient population that had all sorts of comorbidities, all these comorbidities that you talked about. So they were already in there. And then you were trying to separate them from groups that purely had those comorbidities. So you really tried to distill what MECFS was about and how that was looking different. Because in reality, that the complicated cases that GPs and physicians are faced with when they're trying to diagnose or understand ME/CFS, they will have a whole range of different comorbidities. And I think you had that great comment, and I think that was part of, I think, a follow-up paper or just generally what you found in your PhD, that it looked like one of the key components to predicting ME/CFS was comorbidities. Having comorbidities seems to be a central part of actually the disease itself. So I thought that was quite fascinating and an interesting way to look at the illness. And it's not the first time I've heard that. I've heard of GPs and clinicians actually mentioning those exact words from their own experience. And especially, I think that was in criticism of that recent NIH paper. I've heard a few people talk about the fact that comorbidities are central to this illness. So I think that was probably the complicated part, was trying to pull those apart. And it was, I think it was great that we were able to get to that, able to get to that 83%. But in terms of following up that work, so the idea, I guess, to try and find a differential diagnostic which can separate or help a physician make a diagnosis to separate out a lot of these complicated conditions to give them confidence for that diagnosis. How do we, what's the role to progress from there? And what kind of follow-up work are you thinking about doing?
Our UK biobank model showed a modest diagnostic performance. So I think it demonstrated that it is possible to actually differentiate and develop a differential diagnostic model for ME/CFS. So moving forward, we're hoping to obviously improve the classification rate, so the accuracy of the diagnostic, and also refine those 28 health factors into a smaller subjective markers, which may include routine pathology. And then how we're going to do this is we're going to look at some medical records and then see how often these health factors actually appear early on in ME/CFS health trajectories and journeys.
I think that's really important. And I think that something that gets lost is when we're doing research on ME/CFS patients, we're often looking at patients who've had the disease for five, seven, 10 plus years. And in reality, when you're trying to make a diagnosis, you're trying to look at somebody who's just several, 6 months, I guess, ideally, or even less if you could even make an earlier diagnostic of this illness, which would be very helpful since so many, patients get worse without being diagnosed and being provided with advice early on in their disease, or appropriate advice early on in their disease. So I think that is really clever in trying to work out how you could utilize even more routine information, things that are also far-reaching, global, but trying to get that information that's already been created very early on when a patient's gone to naturally see their GP and try to utilize that data within the same type of process that you developed.
And I think using perhaps medical records is a really valuable tool in the way that any kind of model that we develop or potentially develop in the future can be implemented in a clinic with the quickest workflow, or because it's already existing in our infrastructure.
Yeah, exactly. And you get to integrate with potential avenues for medical education even
For
process
sure.
where you're like, this is this, you could potentially diagnose this person, it's telling the clinician you could potentially diagnose this person of ME/CFS. Here are the tools to be able to do something like that. Yeah, I think that's excellent. And so obviously you've also recently been successful with this Mason Foundation grant, which is excellent. This was around looking at the idea of developing tools to predict, or better, really accurately predict a PEM event or a crash, or at least susceptibility towards one in a short time frame. Could you tell us a bit more about this?
One of the things that we also, going back to the UK Biobank, but some of the limitations of the UK Biobank is that the model looks at only one time point and requires patients to go into a clinic or an assessment centre, so that we really wanted our next project to be more accessible to those that are maybe bedbound or like housebound. So this PEM project is really focusing on how we can find a or help patients in their home. So this PEM project would be We'll be analyzing physiological data, biometric data, to see if we can predict PEM events, maybe how long each event may occur, the severity. We're also going to be testing how far advanced can we detect PEM in these physiological data using wearables. And then at the moment, we're currently submitting our ethics, so we're looking for recruitment in, maybe in the next couple of months. So keep an eye on out on that.
Yeah, excellent. I think very excited to see the potential for working that through and kind of what type of markers and stuff we can pull out, I guess, of that type of data, and thinking about it in more of a practical way in which patients use it. I think it's, I'm excited to see how that works, but definitely please, I think what's handy about that is you can recruit more broadly, globally, I think, as well in Australia, make that possible to recruit a larger cohort. So we'll put those information out as
Yeah,
well.
and also capture naturally occurring PEM. So not anything induced by exercise, as we all know that PEM can occur based on any type of event, not just physical activity. So that is also a major factor that we try to consider.
Exactly right. It's a good point as well. Unfortunately, the research that we have to do have so far has been inducing PEM, which is something that we obviously don't want to have to do. But so that's a great benefit of that research. But yeah, so I think it's very exciting potential things that could be utilized, and I really appreciate you spending the time to kind of talk a little bit about that research and the things that you're doing. And yeah, we'll look forward to seeing more outcomes from you in the future.
Cool. Thanks, Chris.
Thank you. Bye.